Brady Quirk-Garvan has stepped down as the chairman of the Charleston County Democratic Party after 5 years and is now supporting Cory Booker for president. I sit down one-on-one with Brady for a special edition of Quintin's Close-Ups. And be sure to download the free Quintin's Close-Ups app in your Apple or Google Play stores. And listen to this interview later on iHeartRadio.
Brady Quirk-Garvan. It's so good to see you again.
It's great to see you as well, Quentin. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome anytime. Obviously, you stunned the low country and really the political world this morning when you announced that, hey, I'm stepping down from the Charleston County Democratic Party. I'm going to focus on my family and also support Cory Booker, who's also running for president of the United States.
That's right.
From this morning to now, what is it like to be Brady Quirk-Garvan?
You know, it's been a great day, to be honest, Quentin. I've heard from people that I haven't heard from in a while, from people I hear regularly, and just nice to reconnect with people. And I will say, so it's been 5 years now that I've been chair, and it's been nice to reflect with folks about what we've been able to do and then share in some excitement about, as you say, being able to spend some more time with family and, hopefully help out on this presidential campaign.
5 years ago to right now, what is the biggest difference about the Charleston County Democratic Party under your helm?
Well, I think there's six differences, Quentin. We flipped six seats from Republicans to Democrats. And what that means is that there's momentum. And genuinely, you know, when I came in, Democrats were in a good position. We were in an okay position. But we've really transformed the party and been able to elect more Democrats, raise more money, and have more of a sense of pride to be a Democrat in Charleston. So for me, I feel very proud of what we've been able to accomplish, and it really has been a team effort. You know, it's not just Brady out there doing this. There's a lot of people who have made that possible, and I think, to me, from 5 years ago till now, it's really this sense of pride in our ability to win.
Let me take you to what you posted on your Facebook page, and I just went back a couple of times to watch your Twitter video.
Sure.
But you basically said this in a nutshell, quote, "For the last 5 years, it's been my honor to serve as the chair of the Charleston County Democrats. I believe strongly that the Charleston County chair, that is, must remain a neutral party and a primary.
Yeah.
But having had the opportunity to meet and have conversations with several candidates in the field, there's one candidate I believe in my soul, is the best leader to take on Donald Trump, win this election, and bring this country together in a way that get results for the people of South Carolina." Let me break all of that down.
Yeah.
The candidate. Why Cory Booker? Why now?
To me, Cory Booker is both an inspirational leader and he's a leader who can get things done. You know, when I look at Cory Booker's track record, he's been able to pass legislation around anti-lynching, criminal justice reform. He's been able to get things done. And then also when you hear him speak, he gives you the sense that we can do better as a country, that if we work together, we'll achieve more together in the future. And so I like that he doesn't bring the divisive politics that I feel like we've had for the last few years. So that's why I'm super excited about Cory Booker.
But how do you take on President Donald Trump now versus 2020?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And I think that, you know, one of the things that Cory Booker talks a lot about is, you know, our job as both Democrats and as people running against Donald Trump is to lay out what our positive vision is. What is our vision for the future? Because I think if we engage with Donald Trump around his terms, if we get into Twitter fights, if we, you know, use the crass language that he uses, not only will Democrats lose, but America loses when we do that. And so I think Cory Booker's ability is, and his skill is his ability to say, here's the positive vision that I want to bring people together around, as opposed to engaging in the banter back and forth with Donald Trump.
What is his vision for the state of South Carolina?
His vision for the state of South Carolina has a couple of parts to it. But, you know, last weekend he was here for a town hall, and when we've had conversations, it's really around increasing teacher salary and making sure that we're making the right investments. You know, we need to make sure that we're investing in kids, in our education system, because we know that if we, make those investments in kids early, it pays off in the long run. If they have better teachers, they get better jobs. If they have more, help at both at school and at home, they're going to go on to greater things. So I think his framework is saying, how do we make sure that we're making the right investments in South Carolina?
And you also go on to say this. This is basically announcing my full-throated support for Cory Booker.
Yeah.
Describe that full-throated support.
Sure. I think what that means is that I am all in for Cory Booker. You know, whoever the Democratic nominee is, I will support full fully, but I believe that it can and will be Cory Booker. And so I want to be able to go out and talk to, you know, club meetings or speak with other Democrats and express my opinion. And you know, to me, what that means is I want the freedom and the ability to say, I support Cory Booker and here's why, and I hope you'll join me. And I think that, you know, as we've talked about before, not just for Democrats, but for all parties, a party chair should remain neutral. You know, if you're, if there's a bunch of Democrats in the race, the Democratic chair should not try and tip the scales there. And so, you know, I want to be able to go out and advocate for Cory Booker. And that's part of why I felt the need to step down, is because I didn't feel like I could be neutral as we went into this Democratic primary.
And in the statement, you also said this quote, at a time when politics is more divisive than ever, when hate and anger seem to be the leading principles of the current administration, it is clearly time for a change.
Mm-hmm.
Senator Booker has always led by trying to bring diverging groups together to create real impactful change. Can you talk to me about those groups?
Absolutely. You know, I think one of the things that Cory Booker can do, both as the nominee and as the president, is to bring together different groups. You know, he can talk to a group of African Americans in Orangeburg who might have different concerns about, you know, a more rural place. And he can come to Charleston and talk about the need for urban infrastructure. He has the ability to talk to, you know, students here at the College of Charleston and talk about student loan debt. But he also has the ability to talk to senior citizens about why Medicare and Medicaid are critical programs that we need to not just protect, but expand and enhance. And so I think his ability to bring those groups together is his ability to not just talk with them, but listen to them. You know, Cory Booker is a great listener. He'll go into different communities and different settings and listen to what people are saying, and then try and come up with a cohesive plan to move forward. And that's something that we desperately need.
What are those critical issues right now, particularly in Charleston County?
I think in Charleston County, you know, the two biggest ones to me are around teacher pay and infrastructure dollars. You know, I feel like those are issues that not only are talked a lot about here locally, but are something that a president can do something about, and many levels of government can do something about. I think that, you know, having a President Booker is going to help make sure that teachers are getting the salary that they deserve for the important work that they do. And it also means that we're going to have the infrastructure dollars so that we can deal with some of the flooding issues here. We can expand the port and bring more commerce to South Carolina and to Charleston. So I think infrastructure dollars and teachers' salary are two big ones.
And you also said this too, the days of trying to win political fights by dividing America into different factions must come to an end. We need to bring together a new coalition of people to restore American integrity and put our country back on the right track. How many people do you have lined up already for this?
Well, you know, that's a good question, Quentin. So, you know, I don't necessarily have a list of people that are on board. But what I will tell you is that one of the reasons that I was excited to back Cory Booker for president is I believe that there's a lot of people who want to be a part of the team. And I think that's one of the critical parts is, you know, Cory Booker is not saying he alone can put America back on the right track. He's saying this is going to be a team effort. He wants people like myself. He wants people, you know, from you know, out on the sidewalk or in the classroom. He wants people to come together and help move us forward. And so when we talk about bringing those folks together, what I'm excited about is that he really wants to bring a diverse coalition of people together.
How do you describe America right now?
I think, honestly, right now, America seems very divided. America seems like there are those who believe every word that Donald Trump says and that he can do no wrong. And there are those who are disgusted by almost every word that he says. And I think one of the things that we need to do as a nation is return to a time, and this is not just a democratic principle, but return to a time and idea when we said, what is best for our country as a whole? What is going to put America back on track? Instead of pitting each other against one another, so, you know, saying we have this faction here and this faction, let's pit urban against rural, let's pit black against white, which is something that we've seen in the Trump administration. I think that we need someone who says, let's come together and find what those commonalities are so that we can move forward and make America better, to make America stronger and make all of us and all of our lives more enhanced.
Oh, you know, I forgot to ask you this. I know, obviously, you mentioned that you won a lot of seats under your chairmanship.
Yeah, sure.
How many more seats do you all need to have the Charleston County Democratic Party as a complete, really?
Sure. So, you know, in my mind, Quintin, I'm not going to be satisfied until we have every seat in Charleston. But, you know, if we win one more seat, one more state house seat or state senate seat, we would control the Charleston County delegation. If we win one or two more countywide seats, we would have a majority of those. So I think that during the 2020 election, we will see a tip in Charleston where Democrats will control a majority of countywide seats of the Charleston delegation, and I'm very excited about that.
I got to bring you back here to the College of Charleston. Obviously, there's a lot of controversy going on about a video that's going viral on social media about something that's allegedly racism. Where are you emotionally as a former College of Charleston student and as a community activist?
Absolutely. You know, I think one of the things that's really important, not just about the College of Charleston, but here in Charleston, is our not only our ability, but the necessity to constantly, consistently, and strongly call out racism when we see it. So, you know, I was glad that the interim president has already made a statement saying this is not, you know, behavior that we tolerate here at the college. And so I think it's just very important that institutions like the College of Charleston step up to the plate and combat racism when they see it. And so I was very glad to see the college make that statement today.
And obviously you told Adam Mantle with the Charleston City Paper that, hey, I got to take care of my 7-1-year-old kid. Of course, I have my regular job.
Yes.
What else can we expect from Brady Quirk-Garvan in the next 7 months?
Well, I think, you know, for me, you're right. I am looking forward to spending some time with, you know, our beautiful little baby. She's awesome and just makes the world better to hang out with her. So I hope to spend more time with her. And I think the other part is, Quintin, you know, really I want to sort of take a deep breath and see where I can be most helpful moving forward. You know, I feel like I've been very proud of the work that I've been able to do with the County Democratic Party. And what I want to do is see where's the best fit for me moving forward. I think there's a lot of great people doing great work in Charleston, and I don't need to replicate that. I don't need to step on their toes. And so if there are places I can help enhance or benefit community activists, I'm going to do that. And that's sort of my plan.
Brady Quirk-Garvan, thank you so much for your time. I really, really appreciate this.
I appreciate it. Thanks, Quintin.
Thank you.